Hello guys, thank you very much for joining in. We're going to be starting out with this session for FRM level 1. I am Ganesh Nayak and I help finance professionals and students to clear this exam, FRM and CFA exam. And today I'm going to be conducting a live session on the building blocks of risk management, which is from your foundation of risk management book. Okay, so before we start the session, give me a quick confirmation guys on chat. If you guys are able to see me, hear me and see the screen properly. Give me a quick confirmation on chat. What about others? Give me a quick confirmation on chat if you guys are able to hear me, see me. Perfect, perfect. Okay, so we're going to be starting out with this session. Please, at the start, okay, at the top of this chapter, you can write that one theory question is expected. One theory question is expected from this chapter. Okay, kindly open up the textbook also along with it. So we're going to be starting now. The building blocks of risk management. This chapter is basically an introduction to the concept of risk management for your FRM level 1. But there are certain concepts in this book or in this chapter which are related to the further part. Over there, they have just given you an introduction of that concept. Okay, the chapter summary, it basically tells you what exactly is a risk, okay, how a financial institution or a bank understands a risk. They have given you the overview. Now they've also talked about how different ways a bank or a financial institution will try to calculate the risk. That means the calculative component or the critical component of the same. How exactly a bank is using a tool or methodology to come to a conclusion whether this risk is important or not, and how do they get the number. Okay, further, there are certain failures that we have seen in the risk management space. We are going to be having a quick understanding of those failures also, where exactly the risk management function fails. Okay, and we are going to be also touching upon few of the aspects related to different types of risk which we see in that the institutions generally face. It can be market risk, credit risk, different variety of it like legal risk. So we're going to be having the discussion on those kind of part also. That is the second section of this chapter. Okay, let us start with the first and the basic idea about this session. Okay, the first part is the risk of the variability of outcome. Can you guys see the first part? What exactly is a risk? So if I'm a risk manager, I have to think of risk as any deviation from the expected value is a risk for me. Any deviation from the expected value is a risk for me. For example, I thought that my portfolio is going to generate a return of 10%. Okay. Now, instead of 10%, it generated 7% or it generated more also, 12%. Both the scenarios are ideally a risk for me. The reason being, I was not able to properly capture or understand the nature of the portfolio. Okay, so whatever you had expected, any variation or deviation that is happening from that expectation is a risk for you. So that is the first point that you have to remember from this chapter. Perfect. The second point, there is a natural trade-off between the risk and return. What does that mean? If you are taking high amount of risk, so you should be compensated with a high amount of return. Okay, so in a very simple and plain language, if you're taking high risk in life, then you should be compensated with respect to the money in terms of the risk that you have taken. Okay, similarly, if you're taking very low risk in the market, then you would be given low amount of return. That is the second point. Second important point that you have to take care of. Natural trade-off between the risk and the return. Okay, the third point which I am right now highlighting on the screen, it talks about is that what is the variation that we see in the loss. Okay, now the example of this would be, do I see a loss which is very smaller amount of losses, or do I see a situation where the loss on some days can be very small and on the some days the loss can be very, very big. That means it can go to the unexpectedly high level. Okay, now that is a risk for me. That is a point of concern for me as a risk manager. okay? So you should ideally try to avoid in such kind of ideally try to avoid to enter such kind of positions where the losses can be very small on some days, and on some days the losses can be very, very high. You do not have control over those things, okay? So that is an important point which I have marked as a star. Next point, the risk management include. Now, the first three points were focusing on what exactly was the risk. If I look at the fourth point, it talks about risk management. That means, if I am an FRM charter holder, if I am a risk manager, how exactly I am going to take steps to make sure that my organization is not facing that risk. Okay, so risk management, the team or the activity, they do a certain type of steps to make sure that the risk is either reduced, okay, or the company or the institution is not facing the impact of it. You have made some alternative arrangement for the same. We'll be looking at those alternative arrangements also in detail. Okay, so fourth point, I hope everybody is reading along with me. I'll be walking you through the book also. Perfect. So risk management is a step of processes which you're going to be doing to either reduce or completely eliminate the risk for the company. We're going to be looking at those examples also. Now let us come to this point, the second last point. Okay, now if you are doing business in the market, okay, so if you want to earn higher return, okay, then only you would ideally enter into those situation which will bring in more risk. Okay, so normally companies, what they do is they want to enjoy that uncertain returns, future higher uncertain return. That's the reason they enter into risky positions. Okay, that is being covered over here. So we have to understand. See, ideally what people can say is you should not enter into those risky positions. That is very simple to say. But if you want to stay in the market, if you want to generate profit, then ideally you will have to take those risky positions. Now your responsibility as a risk manager is to make sure that how company can minimize the impact of that risk. Okay. Last point, which is highlighted on the screen, okay, is telling me that when I'm talking about risk taking, when I explicitly hear a word risk taking, what does it mean? I am taking an additional amount of risk in the market to get the additional amount of return or the profit from the market. That is what is covered in the last point. Okay. Now, this entire slide was giving you an idea about what exactly was a risk. Okay. So it is basically a variability on the expected return. What exactly is a risk management? Okay. It gave you a glimpse of risk management also as a risk manager, what you're supposed to do, an overview. Okay. Let us go towards the book now and let us see the first section. I would want you guys to read the first paragraph. The first paragraph. And see if you are able to connect to those dots or not. The points which we have covered, are you able to connect to dot or not? Simple. The first paragraph, uncertainty in the outcome, that is risk. Whatever you thought, basically there is a variation. Okay. And the variation can be on the negative side, it can be on the positive side also. Okay. Next is, there is a trade-off between the risk and return. We have already covered that point. The next paragraph, risk is not necessarily related to the size of the potential loss. I hope everybody is with me on this paragraph. Kindly read this entire paragraph. It talks about the risk going to an unexpectedly high level. That is my problem. Read that entire paragraph. And when I am explicitly saying the risk going to the unexpectedly high level, I am more concerned about the variability of losses. What does variability of loss means? On some day my losses are very small, on some day my losses are very big. Perfect. So this first two paragraph is talking about what exactly is risk. The next paragraph is going to focus on the risk management. Okay, read the first five lines. Read the first five lines. That ideally you have a risk management team which is basically taking steps or doing some process to reduce the risk of the organization or reduce the risk of the position. Read the part which is highlighted on the screen. Now, if you have read this, that five lines, you would have also read about a line. On top of that, there is a need to manage the unexpected variability of cost also. Now, think from the perspective of a manufacturing company. Okay, Britannia. They manufacture biscuits. Now, whenever they are manufacturing biscuit, they would need raw material. Okay, if every day the price of raw material is going to change, their cost of production is also going to change, and because of which their profit margin will also change. So that is not a good way to do business, right? So what ideally a risk management team would do is they would try to make sure, or they would try to create, they would try to take steps in such a direction that the raw material cost is more or less stable. Because if the raw material cost is more or less stable, your profit margin is more or less stable. Right? So it is also from the perspective of cost, not only in terms of revenue. That is what this line wants to highlight. Okay, I'm assuming all of you guys have read the five lines which I was talking about. Let us go to the last five lines. Okay. Now, when we are talking about risk management, okay, the logic over here is that the company is taking additional risk so that they can generate return for their business. Okay, that is what is risk-taking behavior. Kindly read the paragraph which is highlighted on the screen. So we have completed the first learning objective. First learning objective of this chapter. Give me a quick confirmation, guys. Done. Kindly mention in the chat, done. If you are clear on the concept. All good? Let me take you towards the second learning objective, the risk management process. Perfect. The risk management process. Now, they have given you certain steps, okay, that as a risk manager, you should be taking these steps to identify the risk, to manage the risk, to monitor the risk, all of this. We're going to be talking about that in detail, okay? First, I'll be talking about the steps, okay? I'll take you towards the book. So in the previous section, we said that risk management is a series of action which you are going to be taking to reduce the risk. Okay. That series of action is going to happen through a process. That process is discussed over here. Kindly read the first three lines. Kindly read the first three lines. It's a formal series of action. And when we are talking about series of action, they are talking about the action done by the risk management team. Okay. And what are those actions? The first step is basically to identify the risk. The first step is to identify the risk. Now, this step might be very simple. You might feel that this is very simple, but this is the most critical step where majority of the risk managers fails. Okay? Not many people would have identified that there can be a COVID-like situation which can impact the operations of the business. It can impact the sales of the business and the security of the business. Okay, so if you were not able to identify the risk itself, then you would not be able to calculate that risk. You would not be able to take steps to monitor and manage that risk. Simple. So the first step is a very, very critical step in terms of identification of risk, which a lot of people are not able to do. A lot of risk managers are not able to do because they feel that such a thing cannot happen to our organization. Okay, second step, this is a step where you try to understand more about the risk and try to give it some number. Now, every risk might not be possible for you to convert it into a number. For example, if you're looking at market risk, you can still convert it into some number. But if you're looking at reputational risk, there is no practically a formal method through which you can convert that reputational damage into a number. Okay, you can use some proxy, but that method will not be precise. Okay, so once you've identified the risk, you will try to understand, you will try to measure and manage, okay, the cost or the basically the amount of risk that can be there. You can convert it into a dollar amount. Okay, the third step, mark this third step as star. Third step as star. Okay, now why am I stressing on this third step is basically over here, we would try to understand whether the risk that I'm looking at, is it a normal risk in my business or is it something which can happen unexpected? That means it is happening out of the blue. Okay, so that is the bifurcation that I want to do. See, if it's a normal risk, if it's an expected risk, then I would be taking steps as a part of the business straightforward. Okay, for example, if I have an employee strength of 10,000, okay, there is a big chance that there can be a manual error. So what I can do is lot of activities within my business, I will try to make it automated so that I can reduce that risk of manual errors. Now, this is a risk which I face because I'm running a business with 10,000 people. This is a normal expected risk that is there in the business. So I can take steps. But what about unexpected risk is either you would have not identified the risk, or else if you would have identified the risk previously, you would not have taken that risk seriously into calculation or into the seriousness of that risk. Okay, so the first three steps. Let us go to the fourth step. Address the relationship among the risk. Now, this step is difficult to interpret. The reason being, there can be a scenario where your operational risk is increasing and it is also having an impact on the credit risk. I'll give you a very simple example. Operational risk means your people are doing some mistake, the processes which you are following within the company, the operation of the company, is there's some problem in that. Okay, so for example, there is a process in your company where you onboard the client. Okay, you take the KYC data, all of this, right? You take Aadhaar card. If it's a company, you will get the company information. If suppose today there is a high amount of people leaving that team, the onboarding team, and there is no training happening properly in that team. We call it in corporate style is attrition is very high. Okay, suppose a lot of people from that team has left, and because of which there are a lot of mistakes which are happening. So operation risk has increased in that team, and because of that mistake, you are taking incorrect document from the client when you're onboarding. And because of which what has happened is some of the clients which might be a high risky client, you have given loans to those high risky clients because the documentation was not checked at the first place. And now you have realized because the operation risk was very high, you gave incorrect loan to your customers, which you wouldn't have done if the documentation would have been proper. So this linkage between the risk is very, very difficult to ideally understand. But if your company is managing or having an enterprise risk management framework, which means everything is connected, okay, then it becomes easy for the risk manager to identify the linkages or relationship between the risk. That is the fourth point I'm talking about. Okay, now till the fourth point, primarily my focus was to understand the risk in detail. Now, after this, which is the fifth point, I am going to take steps. Okay. Now, I know what is the dollar amount of the risk, what is the loss that I can face. I've done the calculation. Now, I'm going to take steps. There are primarily four steps that you can do. Okay. Either you can avoid that risk. So, out of all the risks that I'm facing, okay, there can be some risk which I will avoid for the time being because that risk is not important for me. I will give you an example. Suppose you're starting out a new company, okay? You just now started out a company. Now, as a business, you face a lot of risk, okay? One of the risks can be that your employees' health might get impacted and it might impact the operations of the company. But since you have just now started, Your focus is to generate revenue, to grow, and then as you grow it to a certain level, then you will take care of those risks. So at the initial years of your business, you might avoid that risk. Okay, there can be many more examples to it, because at this point of time, it is not important for the business. Okay, so that is where you will take a decision. Okay, I can avoid this risk. Second decision, this is all available in your book also. Okay, we'll come to that part. The second decision that you will take is, you will basically take steps to mitigate that risk. I'll give you an example. Okay. Now suppose you are running a bank, and bank faces a risk that whatever regulations are coming day in day out from RBI, you have to follow that regulation, right? Now if you do not follow, then obviously there is going to be a fine from RBI. So what you will be doing is, you will set up a compliance team within the bank so that the risk of not following the regulatory requirement is reduced. So you have taken steps to reduce that risk. Simple. There can be many more examples. For example, there can be a chance that there can be a terrorist activity within my corporate campus. So I take steps to enhance the security of my corporate campus so that no unknown elements can enter the park. So I have taken steps to mitigate that risk. Okay? Simple. Then there is one more step that I can do, is I can transfer that risk to somebody else. Now this is very interesting. I'll give you an example. Suppose Infosys is having a building, okay, in Mumbai. Okay, there is a risk that there can be a fire in that building. That building can get damaged because of earthquake. There can be so many things that can happen to that building. Okay, so what Infosys can do is, now this risk Infosys is facing, now they can take steps to reduce that risk, but they might feel that, okay, instead of we taking that step, why don't we transfer it to somebody else? So we can take an insurance on the building, okay, and we can reduce our exposure to that risk. Simple? Simple. So this was the third step that you can do. The fourth step is to retain that risk. Fourth step is to retain that risk. Now what does that mean? Okay, there are, if you are running a business, there are smaller risks which you assume that it is going to be there. I'll give you an example. If suppose you are running a credit card business, okay, if you are selling credit card, out of 100, 3 or 4 customers will not be paying you the credit card amount. You cannot actually avoid that risk, because out of 100, 2-3% customers will be there. Okay, so this is the nature of my business. This is the risk that I have to take in the business. I have to retain that, and I have to go ahead. I have to keep doing the business. Okay, so that is basically retaining. So either I can avoid the risk, okay, either I can retain the risk, either I can take steps to mitigate the risk, or else I can transfer the risk. Simple. I'll take you to the PPT, okay, now, but I'll complete the fifth point. I've talked about the fifth point. I'll talk about the sixth point now. The sixth point is explicitly talking about, now sixth point is where you have taken a decision, either you are avoiding, retaining and all of that. You want to monitor that risk. Okay, so normally if you are working in a bigger organization, all the major risks would have been identified. You as a risk management team member, you would only monitor if a particular risk is increasing to a certain level or not. Okay, that is the monitoring process. And that happens in a risk committee meetings. Every month, every quarter, you present your report, which tells whether there is a risk, which particular type of risk is increasing, or whether it is within a threshold limit or not. Okay, so these are the six building blocks of the risk management. How do you manage risk within the organization? Okay, I'm taking you towards the PPT. I'll come back to the book also. Now, read this part. The five bullet points, kindly read the same. And also look at this steps. Kindly read the bullet points and also looked at the steps which are given. Avoid, retain, mitigate and transfer. The second last point is talking about the risk identification process. Like I said, it is a very difficult task. Okay, so they have given you steps how you can identify the risk. We're going to be covering that in the further slides. Simple. I hope everybody has read this slide. I'm moving towards the next slide. Okay, look at the first part. Avoid the risk. The four decisions that I said, we're going to be talking about the first decision. Read this part. Avoid the risk. Now they have given you an example. Suppose I face, if I do export, okay, and I face a huge currency, foreign currency risk, then one way to do is you do not enter into that business. Okay, you do not do export. We primarily avoid that business, or you primarily avoid that project. That is one way to look at it. Read that paragraph, the avoid part. Simple. Retain. Now what they have done is, when they are talking about retain, when I gave you an example, okay, I gave you a very simple real life example, okay, but over here what they are talking about is they have added theoretical parts, and they are saying some of the risk business retain consciously. They know that this is my risk in the business. I have to take this. I have to run with that risk, right? For example, when you run a bank, you know there is a credit risk involved in it. What is the credit risk? You are giving loans to people, and those people might not give you back the loan, and those loans can be NPA, non-performing asset. So that is the core risk of the banking side. So that when you do, when you open up a bank, you actually consciously retain that risk and do the business, right? That is being covered over here as the conscious risk. Now these words are coming directly from your institute book, right? You are taking the decision to retain it. Unconsciously means there are certain risks which will have a financial impact to you, okay, but you have not explicitly focused on that risk. It is by defined, it is coming within the business. Okay, it is very difficult to give you some example for this unconscious risk, okay, but you indirectly include in your decision making. You don't take any particular effort to take that decision. On a nutshell, what you have to remember is when you are retaining a risk, you basically try, okay, you basically try to take steps to make sure that this is my business risk, okay, and I am going to retain that as a part of that business. Smith, I am answering to your query. So your question is, if I know that the loans will turn into NPA, I will ideally not give that loan. I agree with it, but by that logic, you will have to close your bank. Do you agree? You will have to close your bank. When you are running a bank, even if you do 110% assessment, 200% assessment, there will still be loans which will default. That is a core of your business. You cannot avoid it. Simple Smith, kindly confirm on chat if you are able to get the resolution of your query. Let us go to the next part, mitigate. Let us go to the next part, mitigate. Now when I am mitigating, I am basically taking steps. I am basically taking steps to reduce the impact. Okay. Now look at the example that they have done. Now when I am taking steps, it can be a prevention and it can be a proper control. I will give you an example. So for example, if there is a risk that there can be a fire in your building, okay, and you want to mitigate yourself, okay, so one way to do it is you will have a fire extinguisher. Okay, the fire extinguisher is basically a reactive measure. If there is a fire, then only you will do something, right? It's a reactive thing. But when you talk about preventive things, you would make sure, you will take steps to make sure that those risks cannot occur at the first place. that risk cannot occur at the first place. That means you will try to avoid, you will create your building or your office premise in such a way that short circuit cannot happen. The cafeteria which is there, you are not using fire, you are doing everything in induction cooker or induction without fire basically. So those kind of things you will take steps to prevent the happening of the risk. So I have tried to give you as simple as possible. Read that paragraph of mitigate. They have given you example of sprinkler system, burglar alarm. Bhargav, answering to your query, hedging is basically a risk reduction technique. That's correct. Conscious risk, Madhusudan sir, answering to your query, conscious risk and expected risk is different. Because when I'm talking about expected risk, I basically try to calculate that risk. That is expected loss. We're going to be doing that in the future. Let us come to this part, transfer. So one of the easiest example of transferring the risk is taking insurance. Taking insurance. So if I'm taking life insurance on my life, I'm basically passing on my risk to the insurance company by paying a premium. Right? Apart from insurance, you can use derivatives in the market to pass on that risk to somebody else. To pass on that risk to somebody else. So this is the, these are the four steps that we have just now completed. Four steps. Now I will take a quick pause and I will take you towards the book. Now these four points are actually on this next slide. So I'm taking you over here and I'm asking you to read this paragraph. Kindly read this paragraph entirely and let me know in case you face any query. And once you are done reading the four pointers and you are clear, kindly mention in the chat section clear. Perfect. What about others? Perfect. Let us go towards the part which we skipped. Okay. Now I am coming to the first part. I told you that the risk management first step is identification of risk. Now, when you are identifying the risk, obviously there can be so many things that are involved. Okay, it is not easy process. Okay, so if you would remember in the previous slide, we had given a list. We're going to be talking about those methods of identification of risk in detail. Okay, kindly read this paragraph till here. The one which is highlighted on the screen. Okay, it talks about one of the methods which is brainstorming. That means the risk team itself will sit along with some senior guys and they will brainstorm what can happen with the organization. What worst things can happen with the organization so that we can protect it. Madhusudan sir, answering to your query, if you are avoiding the risk, then you would not transfer or you would not mitigate. You will take steps for those risks at a later stage, primarily. Because you might not enter into that business now because you're not prepared. You might enter into that business after few years. Right, Madhusudan sir? And I'm assuming that all of you guys have read the first four lines. So when we talk about brainstorming, we basically ask people, relevant people, to come together and discuss and get the answer what risk your business might be facing. What risk your business might be facing. So, for example, if I'm a bank holding company, what I will do is I will get some people from my wealth management business, some people from my asset management business, investment banking, right? So all of these different divisions, and they will discuss what particular risk is directly related to your business and what extraordinary things can happen in terms of risk to your business. That is brainstorming. Okay. Next is we can also do survey. Do you see this line? Now these surveys are generally done in such a way that somebody who is filling the survey, he will not understand what it is actually been, what is the purpose of this survey. So they would try to create a survey in such a way that okay, they will ask you how many employees are there in your team. For per vice president, how many employees are reporting to a vice president? Okay, how many people are normally taking leave on a day-to-day basis on an average? So those kind of questions they will ask, and on the basis of those questions they will try to understand what is the risk of your business. Okay, obviously to form those questionnaires you need expert help. Okay, and that is why if you are working in an organization, you will find many a times you get a questionnaire from the senior management asking for few things, and there might be 5, 7, 10 things to fill up. Okay, and which might not be very much relevant to your work, but they want to understand the risk or the mode of the entire business. That's the reason they ask you. Okay, so second step is basically to do survey. Okay, survey of those people who are directly dealing with the risk. Okay, now one more example of this would be when you go to a bank branch. Okay, you have the front officer. Who's taking the document, who is basically interacting with the customer. He will be also more aware about the risk which the retail bank might be facing. So you can do their surveys also. Simple. Those are frontline personals. Next is industry level resources. Now what is industry level resources? For example, in an IT sector, you have an industry body which is NASSCOM. Okay. Similarly, in banking sector, you have a banking federation. Right. So what do they do is they basically try to create some industry level resources, or say for example checklist, or for example tools which each bank can use to mitigate their certain types of risk. So you can use that also to understand what all different risks are available in my business. What all different risks are available in my business. Okay. So that those are industry level resources which are available. So a lot of the times regulators do scrutiny, they do audit of companies and they share the reports with other bank. So those are industry level resources. Simple. So we have looked at first three points, which is brainstorming, survey and industry level resources. Okay. Now I'll take a quick pause and I'll take you towards the PPT. Okay. There are more points related to it. We have covered the brainstorming wala piece. Simple. We have covered the industrial loss, industry resource, and we have also covered the structured interview in terms of survey or questions. Okay, next part is the loss data analysis. Now this part is very critical, and this is a responsibility generally of the risk team. What do they generally try to do is they try to understand what has been the historical loss of the organization. That essentially means what all bad things have happened with the organization. Okay, in the history, and on the basis of that, you will try to analyze and you will try to see where we have lost money and what all problems, what all control failure has led to those losses, so that you can work on those controls and you can reduce the loss number in the future. That is the analysis. Okay, now how do they get the loss data? So if your organization is well established, what they generally do is whenever any loss happens in the organization, they will have a central system where they have to input the data. They have to give all the details of what happened in that incident. Okay. Who is responsible for it? Who is going to do the action plan? That means who is going to work towards not happening of similar type of risk in the future. Okay. And that data is also presented in the risk team, risk committee meetings, basically. Simple. So that is nothing but your loss data analysis. So you can read this part. So I primarily focused on the internal loss data, which is my company's loss data. But there are certain bodies which helps you to get the external loss data. For example, ORX. For operational risk, there is a company, there is a company which is formed by the banking sector itself and which gives external loss data, the new information of operational losses, which is available in the newspaper across the globe. They take that data and they pass it on to banks. Okay, that is nothing but external loss records. Kindly read that loss data analysis. So one of the example of loss data analysis would be fat finger error. When we say fat finger error, incorrect payment made to the customer. So there was an incident in Deutsche Bank where they had made an incorrect payment of around $6 billion, if I'm not wrong, to one of their agent bank. They got the money back, but that error itself was a big thing. That is an example of loss data analysis. Simple. Next is basic risk triage. Now, every risk cannot be quantified. Okay, you can read this part. That means there are certain risks which needs subjective assessment of the risk manager who is actually day in, day out working in that domain to understand the frequency and the severity of the risk. Now, what is the frequency? Within a year, how many times we can expect that risk to happen? And what is the severity? Whenever that risk is going to happen, what is the impact to my business? Financial and non-financial both. Financial and non-financial both. Okay. So basic risk triage. Read that part. Now a lot of this content is coming from your institute book, which is not explicitly mentioned in the Swedger. Let us go towards this part. Hypothetical what if scenario. Now normally international bank, what they would have is they would have a team specifically for these kind of what if analysis. They are generally called a stress testing or scenario team. Okay, what they will do is they will have their system, okay, which is having all the data of the trades that are happening every second within the bank. Okay, when I'm saying trade, that means we are taking positions either for the client or for our own portfolios within the financial market. Okay, and those risks are on my book. Okay, suppose if I have taken the bond portfolio. Now bond, when the interest rate goes up, my bond portfolio value goes down. That's an inverse relationship. Okay, that is there in the market. We'll talk about this in detail and we do bond valuation. But what I want to highlight is that suppose I am looking at a bond portfolio, what I will do is I will say, okay, if the current interest rate is 7% in India, if that interest rate moves to 10% immediately, what is an impact to my portfolio of bond? Okay, so we will try to do that scenario analysis. We'll try to give a stress to one of the key variables. So in my example, the key variable was interest rate. Similarly, there can be other key variables also, like the GDP of the company, country, okay, currency, oil prices, okay, inflation, that can also impact my positions. Okay, so what you will do is you will try to create, you'll try to create a what if scenario. If such a scenario is happening, what is the loss that I'm facing? That generally happens in scenario or stress testing. Read this part. The last part, it refers to the worst case scenario. It refers to the worst case scenario. Okay. So we have completed 6 steps to identification of risk. I'm taking you towards the last 2 steps. Okay. Now this part, the frontline observation. Now this is basically, this is different from survey, because survey is initiated by the management of the organization. Okay, it comes from top to down. But frontline observation is basically where your, I'll give you an example from retail bank perspective. Your branch manager is able to look at the customer, and if the customer is coming for loan, he will try to do his own judgment whether that customer is genuine or fraud. Okay, depending upon the interaction of those frontline officers with the customer, they can get some information, and on the basis of that, they will take the decision whether there is a risk involved or not. That is called as frontline observation. Frontline observation. So whenever you apply for a loan also, and it goes through a bank manager will definitely ask you questions. Why do you need loan? Okay, how will you repay the loan? All of that, your profile, everything he will try to ask. Simple. That is a frontline observation. The last part is following the trail. Now, what does following the trail means? What you will try to do is you will do a backward analysis. Something already has happened in the past. You know that impact has happened. You'll do a backward analysis and you will try to reach the cause of that issue. And then once you reach the cause, once you identify the problem, then you can say, okay, if this problem comes back, how much loss we will face today? Do we have control over that problem or not? So that is how you'll do the backward analysis. Read this section. You'll try to identify the gaps in the process. If a certain issue has happened, why that issue has happened? Read that part, following trail. I hope everybody is with me till this steps that we have just now covered. Now, kindly read this last three part. We have already covered this section. Kindly read the last three lines. We have covered this in the question itself, scenario analysis and all. So, loss data analysis means you are doing some calculation on the basis of loss historical data. When you talk about following the trail, you will take one incident and you will do a deep dive into that. Let us read the last three lines for more quantitative approach. Once you are done, now when we talk about identification of risk, now in your theoretical context, what they have given is there can be a range of way where you can identify. Okay. And this is slightly tricky. Okay. What they have tried to do is look at this diagram. Look at this diagram. Now what is the intention of this is the expected loss. Look at the first sphere, the expected loss. This was something we knew that this is going to happen to us. Okay. And ideally what bank would do is if suppose I know that out of 100, 2 or 3 people will default on my loans. So I would try to make sure that those losses are recovered from all the customer. How? I will basically ask for a processing fee. I'll basically ask for a commission. Okay. Or else I will try to raise the rate of interest slightly higher so that the loss which I'm facing because of this 2-3 customer, I'm making sure everybody is paying and I'm getting protected from that loss. That is only possible if you know about that loss. That is expected loss. Fairly simple. Now what is unexpected loss? If suppose you were expecting that out of 100, 3 people will default. Now, in a particular year, out of 100, 50 people defaulted. That is an unexpected loss. That is an unexpected loss. That means the variation in the expected piece is the unexpected loss. Now, till now, whatever discussion that we have done, we have only reached to this level, unexpected loss. But we can also think about these two parts, known unknowns and unknown unknown. Okay, I'll ask for these two categories. I will ask you to read something. Okay, come to this section. Read the first three lines. It tells you about the spectrum of risk that is going to happen to the organization. The first three lines. Okay. Now, I hope everybody has read the first three lines. Now, bifurcating the two parts, known unknown, which is also known as Knightian uncertainty, right? The first category, okay, what exactly it is? It is those risks which we might get impacted as a business or as a bank. We might. Okay, so we know about that risk, but we say there is very small chances that we might get impacted. Simple. That is called as known unknown. Okay. But when we talk about the next category, which is unknown unknown, we have not even, those risks are not even in our thought process. Those risks are not even in our thought process, and we have not even discussed about it. Now, I'll give you a very simple example to you. Now, hotel industry, because of COVID, 6-7-1 year, the hotel industry has not been able to open properly. Now, before that scenario, nobody would have thought that to your business as an hotel, you would not be able to open shops. You will not be able to interact with the customer. This is an example of unknown unknown, something which you could not even have imagined. Okay, that is an example of unknown unknown, right? So there were two categories, known unknown, where you know, okay, something might happen to me, okay, but very less chances, or you might say that, okay, we consider that those risks might not happen to me very often, very less chances. But unknown unknown are purely out of the blue. Okay, so read this part. When you are talking about tail risk event means exceptionally loss event, worst to worst situation. Read that three lines and mark that three lines as star. I hope everybody is good till here. Let me take you towards the next part. Read this last two lines. Okay. Now, the last two lines tells you that as a risk manager, there can be so many things that can happen to your company or your business. Okay. Now, you should focus on identifying the risk. Okay. And bring it from these unknown areas to the known areas. Okay. The upper two areas to the lower two areas where you have clarity about the risk. Okay, but if suppose it is difficult for you to quantify the risk, then you might not be in a position to bring it to the known area. Okay, I'll give you an example. Suppose if your website is down for 10 minutes, how much damage in terms of customer relationship it is going to happen to the bank? It is very difficult to quantify. Okay, so if that is the situation, you might not be able to bring those risks from unknown to known. That is what these two last two lines talks about. Simple. We have already covered this paragraph. We have already covered this paragraph. Now, I'm taking a quick pause. Give me a quick confirmation. We have covered the entire section which talks about the identification of risk. We have looked at the risk spectrum also. Give me a quick confirmation, guys. Are we good to go? Perfect. So now we are going to be entering into the challenges which are faced by risk management. Now, when we are saying challenges, it means there are certain things which risk management is not able to solve over the years. Okay, we're going to be talking about those things. Okay, the first is basically, read this part. Risk management has not been able to identify bigger crises happening in the market. Okay, for example, there was Asian currency crisis. Okay, dot-com bubble that happened in the early 2000s. Then there is a 2007-08 crisis, euro crisis. So as a risk managers, or basically the methodology that we use, we were not able to identify the risk and we were not able to stop those things happening in the market. Read that paragraph, you'll get an understanding. So 2007-08 crisis, the great financial crisis, where there was a liquidity crunch in the market, people were not putting their money out, and because of which a lot of banks failed, a lot of banks had to be taken over by the government. Simple. I hope everybody has read that part. Now, why that 2007-08 crisis happened? They have also written that in a simple line, where there are few participants who are taking concentrated risk. Concentrated risk. I'll give you an example. If suppose there is only one insurance company in India, okay, LIC, and everybody is taking an insurance from LIC only. And if tomorrow any big disaster happens in India, because of which a lot of people die, so LIC will be filled with claim. They might not have the sufficient amount of cash flow to pay back. This is happening because of the concentration. Everybody is taking the insurance from LIC only. Right? So in 2007-08 crisis, what happened is very few people took a lot of bigger exposure, which they were not able to sustain. Okay, we have a specific chapter in this book also in further parts where we're going to be talking about the anatomy of the great financial crisis in detail. Now I'm taking a quick pause and taking you towards the PPT. We have already covered this section. We have talked about the risk spectrum. Okay, Knightian part, Knightian uncertainty part and all of it. The challenge one. Okay, we have just now covered this part. So ideally, we are not able to understand where the concentration is happening of the risk. Okay. Let us go towards the next paragraph. The next paragraph. Now look at this part. Accounting fraud. You must have heard about Satyam fraud, where you're showing fake sales, fake employees, okay, and trying to manipulate the book, cook the book. Okay, so as a risk management professional, you are not able to identify the accounting frauds happening in the companies. That is a big problem for us. Okay, if our methodology, if risk management is strong, we should have been able to identify. Okay, because these risks lead to bigger damages to the organization. Read this paragraph. And they have used the word corporate governance failure. What does that mean? When the management itself fails, so there is no checks and balance in the organization. And because of which, you face a situation where there is a lot of losses happening. Simple. Read that paragraph. Sunil, answering to your query, see, putting financial crisis into a particular category would be very difficult, but it is more sort of market risk. I hope everybody has read this part, read the paragraph. Let me take you towards the next part, next paragraph. Okay, derivative products. Okay, derivative product. Now over here, the focus is that when you do trading in the financial market, okay, there are a lot of derivatives, like for example forward contract, where you do not get anything right now. Okay, you get the payment, you get the money if you are in profit at the maturity. But what happens is that those forward contracts which you have already signed, you basically show it in your book by calculating the today's value, which is unrealized value. What is unrealized? You have not received the cash. It is only on paper. It is only on paper. Okay. So what happens if suppose you are taking complex derivative in which you see lot of money coming in on paper, but in reality in your bank account the money is not coming. Okay, so there has been cases where people have taken complex securities, okay, and in which they have inflated the financial positions. The primary reason for that was because their salaries, their bonuses, top management was dependent on that revenue which was shown as per paper amount. Okay, so generally what we do is we talk about accounting profit and economic profit. Accounting profit means on paper you are able to see. Okay, similarly economic profit means actual profit in your bank account, right? So these, there have been cases where management people or traders have been able to manipulate the numbers by taking complex strategies to show that they are in profit, and they have been able to take bonuses on that. Read that paragraph. So there has been a case of Baring Bank where Nick Leeson was basically one of the trader who created a lot of fake trades. He created a lot of fake trades, and on the basis of those fake trades, he showed it that he had made a lot of profit and he got a lot of good amount of bonus also. Okay, you guys can read about that case in your learning from financial disaster chapter from this book. Now for the time being, read this paragraph. Perfect. Next paragraph, basically talking about, see, ideally in a business, in an economy, okay, what should happen is people who are in a position to take risk, they should only take that risk. In a simple language, somebody who has the willingness and the capacity, they should only take that risk, or else it will create chaos in the market. Okay, that is one part. Now if suppose, I'll give you example that will help you understand that when you are transferring the risk, you are not eliminating the risk in the economy. I'll give you an example. Suppose if you have taken an insurance for your building, office building, and you have taken an insurance from Tata AIG. Okay, now you are making a premium payment to Tata AIG. Only thing that you have done is you have transferred the risk to somebody else. In the entire economy, the risk is not mitigated. It has been passed on to somebody else. Now Tata might take some reinsurance from some bigger company. Okay, and then they are passing on that risk to somebody else. So what we want to highlight is that when you are doing risk management, ideally what you try to do is you are not reducing the risk in the economy. It is being passed on to somebody else. Okay, so ideally what should happen is it should go to those people who have the capacity and the willingness both to manage that risk, or else it will lead to a problem. Right, read this first three lines. It does not result in overall risk elimination. Right, somebody, if suppose you are going to pass on that risk to somebody else, okay, you have taken an insurance, and suppose that bad event happened, your building collapsed, then you go to the insurance company, you make the money, you get the money back. So you are getting the money back, somebody else is also losing, right? That's the reason you are getting the money back. That means it's a zero sum game. Somebody is going to win because somebody is losing. Okay, the only concern is it should not happen that most of the people start losing simultaneously. That is what is being covered over here. That would lead to widespread economic crisis. Read the paragraph highlighted on the screen. Read the paragraph highlighted on the screen. Perfect. Let us go towards measuring and managing risk. Okay, now when I'm talking about measuring and managing risk, okay, we are going to be looking at different ways to do that. Okay, the first and foremost way is quantitative risk measure. Now, what is quantitative? You are going to do the actual calculation, and over here we will be introduced with a topic called VAR, which is value at risk. When you open up book 4, the first 3 chapters is talking about VAR. Okay, so it's an important concept, but over here they've just given you an introduction. Okay, now what we try to do is when we look at VAR, okay, I'll give you a statement to understand. Okay, so if suppose I'm saying a 1-day VAR at the rate 95% confidence level is $100. Simple. Now, what does this statement talks about? That on any given day, okay, there is 5% chance. How come 5%? Okay. I hope everybody is able to see. 1 minus 95%, that means 5%. Simple. So I'm repeating, on any given day, there is only 5% chance that my loss is going to be greater than $100. Okay, there is only 5% chance. This is as per the statement. Okay, now there are 3 important components in this statement. The first is 1 day. Now, instead of 1 day, I could have written 1 year, 1 week, 1 month. Okay, so if I'm writing 1 month, then how will I interpret? On any given month, I am 5% confident. There is only 5% chance that my loss is going to be greater than $100. So this is the first component. Second component is this 95%. Now instead of 95%, I can take any other number. 97%, 99%, any number. There is no problem with that. Suppose if I had taken 99%, then this number is going to be 1%, because 1 minus 99% is going to be 1%. If suppose I had taken 97%, then this number is going to be 3%. Simple. Only my way of telling will change. Right? The next part is this number, $100. Now this $100 is the calculated number. I'll show you one of the calculation, one of the methods of VAR, and I'll show you the calculation also. Okay, but this is what the VAR incident talks about. Okay, let me ask you to read that content first. You will get more clarity. Read this paragraph, the first paragraph, end to end till here. The highlighted part, read the same and see what is the statement that they have made. 1 day VAR of $2.5 million at the 95% confidence level. What does that mean? On any given day, there is 5% chance that I would lose greater than $2.5 million. And obviously this $2.5 million is a calculated amount. I'll show you the calculation in some time. Simple. Now VAR can only be calculated, okay, because only means it will give you a better answer when you are looking at a position which is liquid. What does that mean? Liquid position means there is active trading happening of that asset. So you are able to get the prices of that asset easily. So if you have a liquid position, then it becomes easy for you to do that calculation. I'll show you the example also where I'll tell you why this position is liquid. Okay. And under normal situation. Normal situation means not 2007-09. That was crisis. That is not normal situation. Okay. So VAR is generally helpful when there is normal situation. What can happen? What is the loss that you would face? Okay. When I'm referring to crisis, it means the entire economy or entire banking system facing the risk. Simple. next part, these three lines, okay, it is less useful and potentially dangerous when we are trying to identify for non-normal. So in the above line, I said it is possible to calculate in the normal situation. Now the problem with non-normal is that you will get the answer, but that will not be the true picture of the risk. That will not be the true picture of the risk, because in the crisis, your number has to come higher, because you are facing the risk in the entire economy. Okay, so when there is non-normal situation, VAR will not help you in a right way. Okay, illiquid position, it will not help you in a right way. And if you are looking out for a risk which is a bigger time frame, that means 5 years, 10 years, then it might not give you the right answer. Generally, we calculate VAR maximum to 1 year. Okay, in market risk, you calculate VAR for 1 day also, you calculate VAR for 10 day also. Shorter period, VAR is possible. Longer period, maximum till 1 year, we can use it. But after that or beyond that, the number is available, but you might not get the right picture. You would actually underestimate the risk. Now, I'm taking a pause. Any confusion in the first paragraph? Guys? Any confusion in the first paragraph? If not, then I will start with the second paragraph. Now over here, they have shown you an example. They have shown you an example, and in this example, what they have done is they have taken 1000 monthly return. Do you see this monthly return? My example, which I'm going to show, is something different. Okay. And they have got a number after doing some calculation. They got this number of -15.5%. Okay, when they multiplied this -15.5% is the total value of the portfolio or the asset. Okay, the value of that asset was $1 million. They got this number, which is $1,55,000. This is the VAR amount. So in my example, I have directly written $100. Okay, but this $100 is basically some percentage multiplied into the value, which is coming to this $100. Simple. The example that has been shown, they have done the calculation, they have got the answer, and they have converted that percentage into dollar amount to get that number, which is $1,55,000. In my example, that was $100. Simple. And they have also calculated some histogram of the monthly return. Okay, some histogram of the monthly return. Now, what I have done is, I have taken the data of the asset. One second. I hope everybody is able to see the Excel file. Okay, I'll just zoom in on this part. So what I've done is, I have taken the asset price. Okay, daily asset price. So I had only these two columns, asset column A and column B. Okay, so I'll just take these two columns. I'll just copy it and I will create a new example so that you guys can see the calculation happening. Okay. So this is the asset price, daily asset price. Now, since the asset is liquid, I am able to get daily asset price. If it would have been illiquid, it might be the case that I might get infrequent data. When the infrequent data is there, I might not be able to find the VAR properly. And this method which we are looking at is basically historical VAR analysis. Okay. So I will first create the returns of the data. Okay, now when I am calculating the return, I want to find the daily returns. Because I am getting daily data. Simple. Now daily return means when the asset price was at 41, it moved to 42.93, what is the return that it has generated? So ideally what I will be doing is, I will be taking the log natural. This is called continuous return. Now I am not going to do a deep dive into that. Those things, those continuous return is going to come to your bond valuation piece in detail. Don't worry about it. Okay. So I'll take a log natural, the latest price, which is 42.89, divided by the old price. And I will get the return. What is the return that I'm looking at? The return is 2.655. Now this return is basically my asset price has moved from 41.8 to 42.9. That is a 1 day price change. And that is the return that I see. Simple. Similarly, I can calculate the return for other stuff also. Do you see there are certain returns which are negative? See, because from 43.75, it has gone down to 43. So there is a negative return also, right? So what I will do is, I will take this data. Okay, one second. I will take this and I will copy till the end. So now I have got how many returns? I have got around 373 returns. I have got 373 returns. Okay. Simple. Now what I will be doing is, I will be taking the value of this returns and I will sort it. And sort it in such a way that the lowest return is, I'm going to start with the lowest return to the highest return. Okay. This is just for your understanding. You don't have to do anything in the anything of this sort in the exam. This is for your understanding. Don't worry. Okay. So what I will do, I've selected the entire data point and I am doing a sorting. Do you see the worst return that I see? Worst return is -19%. -19%. What I will do is, I will do the ranking of this data. What does ranking means? This is the first lowest return, -19. Second lowest return. Likewise, I will keep on calculating for the entire data. I am taking a quick pause. Are you guys able to understand what I am doing on the Excel sheet? Give me a quick confirmation. Come on, guys. Perfect. Okay, great. I'm going purposely very slow. Okay, for this topic. I'm repeating, you don't have to do this in the exam. It is just for your understanding. Okay. Now, I'm going to find is, I have an asset which had this price. So this price, daily price, was of an asset. I had made an investment of around $1 million. Okay. I'm just taking this as an example. Around $1 million is the asset investment which I have done in this asset. Okay, simple. Okay. Further, I want to find the 95% VAR. Okay. So if I want to do this, how will I do it? First, I will count the number of returns. I will count the number of returns. How can I do it? I'll count the values. I am getting 373 returns. 373 returns. Okay. Now my concern is, since I am looking out for 5% VAR, I want to find the lowest fifth percentage point. The lowest fifth percentage point. If this is the spread of the data, this is negative side, this is positive side. I want to find the lowest point over here, which has 5% this side and 95% this side, because I want to find the 95% VAR. Okay. So if I want to find that lowest 90, lowest 5% point, what I will do is, okay, I want to calculate var for how much? 95%. Okay. Alpha. Alpha means 1 minus 95%. That is 5%. Initially, I have not explicitly said, taken the word alpha. It is also called as level of significance. Okay. The 5% part. Now, in terms of number of losses, what is the worst 5% number? I will do what? 5% into 373. What is the number that I am getting? It is 18.67. Now, it is above 5, 18.5. So, what I will do is, I will round it up. When I am rounding it up, I am basically taking it from 18.65 to 19. One second. 19. Okay. Now, what does this 19th number represents? This number is representing that the 19th lowest return is my var percentage. So, what I will do is, I will start first lowest, second lowest. I will go towards the 19th lowest. This is my var percentage. Negative 4.127. Now, did you get an understanding? In the example, they have calculated negative 15.5. How did they get the number? We have done the same process and we have got our own number, which is negative 4.127%. This is my var percentage. This is my var percentage. But if I want to calculate the dollar amount, the way they had calculated 1,55,000, how can I do it? Okay. I will have to. So my var percentage, I'm just taking this number over here so that it becomes easy for us to calculate. So what was that number? Negative 4.127. This is my var percentage. If I want to calculate the var amount, I will have to do this. I will have to multiply this var percentage into the value of my portfolio. Let us assume that my value was 1 million. So what is the answer? Answer is going to be like this. 41,273 is my var amount. This is the number. This is the number that we got from the book. If I look at the book, these were negative 15.5 and this is the final var amount. Okay. If you want to look at this diagram, you can also create this diagram by taking the returns. If I take the returns, one second. If I take the return, go to the insert section. One second, my PC is slightly slow. I go to the recommended charts. It will show me an histogram. So, are you guys able to understand? This is the same chart. This is the same chart that you guys can see on the table. And in the diagram, which is available in the book, what is happening is that they have bifurcated that point, negative 15.5, below which it is 5%, above which it is 95%. This is how you actually calculate historical VAR. Now, give me a quick confirmation. Did you guys understood this entire section of VAR? Please mention good to go if you are confident on what is happening in this case. Please mention good to go. Simple. Let us go to this part. See the professor's note. The initial point that I made, that VAR is basically a topic coming from book 4. Over here, this is just an example that they have shown you and it is called as historical VAR. Simple. Let me take you towards the next part, which is economic capital. Now, if you want to understand economic capital, you would have to first understand what is expected loss and what is unexpected loss. Okay. Now, let us talk about this part. If suppose the distribution of my return is this, This is same which I created on the Excel file. Same return. Okay, the distribution. This is a negative side, that means the loss side. This is a positive side. Okay. Now, let us assume this is zero. Okay. Now, if suppose I know for sure that in my business, I am able to generate a loss because of the natural or basically the expected loss in my business is going to be around 3%. So I'll take an example of credit card. So out of that credit card business, almost 3% defaults. Okay. So the expected loss, which I write as EL, is 3%, and in dollar value, it is, let us assume it is $100. I'm just taking the simple number. Okay. Right. So if suppose you know as a business that on an average you face this loss of 3%. Okay. So what you would ideally do is you would try to cover this gap by charging customer what? You will try to cover this gap by charging customer fees. Okay. Commission. Processing fees and commission. Okay. So the moment any customer takes a card, credit card, he will have to pay 500 rupees as a joining fee or basically the processing fee. So what you are doing is the loss that you might face because of those three customers, you are compensating it with all of them. Everybody is going to pay. Okay. So in short, what you are doing is you are trying to mitigate the loss which you normally would face in the business. Okay. Now what is going to happen? Think about this. Now, this is my expected loss. So on any particular year, I am expecting 3% to lose. But if suppose there is 1 year in which only one customer defaulted, there can be a scenario, right? Because this is just an expectation. In real life, next year what will happen, I am not sure. Okay, so there can be a scenario that only one customer defaulted, or there can be a scenario that 70% customer defaulted. So my next concern is, if I am able to cover my expected loss, I should be able to understand this number of 3%, how it can vary, how much fast it can vary, and to till what extent. So what we generally do is we try to find the worst case loss. We try to find the worst case loss over here, which we call it as unexpected loss. This is nothing but VAR that we have calculated. Okay. Okay, let us assume that this talks about 70%. That means 70% of my customers have defaulted the credit card. Okay, and I'm taking a number, hypothetical number, that this is $1,000. Okay, so now look at this diagram. What is happening? On an average, I was expecting a loss of $100 and I tried to cover myself from $100 loss. But this my next problem is this $100 can increase. So I've calculated this unexpected loss. So ideally what I would do is I will take this gap. What is this gap? $900. And I will keep this money aside. This is my economic capital. This is how banks work. This is how bank work. So when you are thinking about credit VAR calculation in the Basel norms, this is how you keep aside $900. So what I am doing is, if I want to protect myself from that 70% loss or 70% scenario, I will keep $900 aside as a liquid amount so that if that situation arises, I have sufficient amount of money to protect myself. Simple, that is nothing but economic capital. Okay? That is nothing but economic capital. If I am not collecting this $100 from my customer, if I am not collecting $100 from my customer, then entire $1,000 is my economic capital. Simple, I will have to keep entire $1,000. Right, but in my example, I am taking that $100 directly from the customer by changing the pricing. And the rest $900, I am keeping my own sub-capital aside. This is called as economic capital. Read this part. The paragraph related to economic capital, kindly read the same. One second. Kindly read that paragraph. Economic capital is unexpected loss minus your expected loss. Bhargav, I have tried to answer your query. Sunil, beyond unexpected loss, there can be so many scenarios where the losses can happen. But what I can do is, on the basis of historical behavior, I can say that this is the worst that I can face the loss. Okay? Tomorrow anything can happen. Right? You cannot be 110% sure, na, when you are doing the business. All good? Sanchita, when you are collecting money from the customer, how are you collecting? You are trying to change the pricing. So if a normal customer would get a loan at 7%, I am charging 7.12%. So that is the way I am trying to collect the money from the customer. It is with the company only. That is the reason I am keeping only $900 additionally as an economic capital. Right, Sanchita? Rajat, this is primarily my unexpected loss. This is not the unknown reason. We have not even talked about it. I have tried to answer the queries of people. Kindly confirm whose query is resolved on the chat section. Okay. Economic capital. I hope everybody has read this part. If suppose I am facing a risk of $2.5 million. And if I keep $2.5 million aside. Okay. Then I have sufficient capital to protect myself. But it doesn't mean that I'll be protected 100% of the time. Suppose there was a bad day of the bank, and on that day, the loss that the bank faced is around 500 million. You have kept only $2.5 million. How will you save your bank? Is everyone clear on this part? The economic capital. Economic capital. Perfect. Let us move towards the. So right now we have completed the quantitative aspect. Quantitative means I can calculate something. I can calculate something. Sanchita, I am answering to your query. In my example, I am actually keeping $1,000 only. $100 is from the customer, $900 is what I am additionally keeping. Okay? Let us go to the qualitative risk assessment. Now, what is qualitative risk assessment? These are subjective risk assessment. The first example of that would be scenario analysis. Now, think about this. If you are a bank and you have a portfolio of stocks, bonds, derivatives, then you can create a scenario to understand what is worst case that can happen. So you are creating a scenario, India-Pakistan war, okay, Japan-North Korea war, okay, a particular country defaulting, okay, Pakistan defaulting on its debt is also going to impact you, because every other country is interlinked. So when there is a global event, for example, China-US trade war, it also impacted us, right? US government facing charges on Iran, because of which our oil prices increased, our oil cost increased, right? So we had nothing to do with it, right? But still, we face that impact. So we will see at different scenarios, we'll try to create those scenarios and see if this scenario happens, what is going to be the impact to my bank portfolio? And obviously, you will try to create a worst case scenario, extreme scenarios, right? Read this paragraph. Read this entire paragraph. And see and try to connect if you are able to understand what I've just said. Simple. scenario analysis, and that is the reason I have explicitly said what if analysis. Okay, now when we do scenario analysis, we take sometimes historical scenarios. For example, if today 2007-8 crisis again happens, what is the loss that I might face? That is historical scenario. Now when I said China Japan war, that is prospective. That means that has not happened in the history, a bigger war. And if that happens, then what is an impact on me? That is a different ball game. Okay. So I've completed scenario analysis. I'm assuming that people are good with this. I'm taking you towards the next part, which is stress testing. Now, what is stress testing? It basically means you are stressing, you are putting a stress on the entity, on the company. Okay. So for example, if you are a bank, so for a bank, there is a liability side, there is an asset side. Now what is a liability? Liability means bank is raising money through, there are so many ways. Bank can raise money from depositors. Bank can raise money by issuing commercial papers. Right? Bank can raise money through bonds. There are so many ways. But these are liabilities for bank because you have raised money, okay, through a certain method and you have to repay that to the customer. What do bank do? They take money, okay, they take the money and they create asset. Either they will invest in the market, that means bonds and everything, or else they will give loans to the customer. That can be a commercial loan, that can be a retail loan, educational loan, like that. Commercial loan means business loan. Okay, now suppose on an average my cost of borrowing the amount from the market, that means depositor, everything, is around 4%. Okay, on an average, the asset side that I have created, where I am investing in the market and giving loans, okay, that amount is, say for example, 10% on an average. Okay, now I will try to put a stress to the entity stating that if this 4% increases to 7%, what is the impact on my bank? I hope everybody is able to connect. Now, you might say, okay, there is still a gap of 3%. That is not how it works. You have a salary to pay. You have an office to maintain. You have an ATM rent to pay. So those costs will also be there, right? So if your gap, which is a net interest margin, if you lose that gap, if that gap becomes very narrow, because you are saying that, okay, my liability side is going to increase from 4% to 3%. What is the stress that the entity will face? What is the stress that the bank will face? Simple. This is one of the example. Okay. I can give you one more example. Suppose if I have a bond portfolio, which is a global portfolio of bonds, and that portfolio is around $500 million. Okay. And the major exposure of these bonds were primarily US bonds, corporate bond, government bond. If suppose tomorrow interest rate in US, which was ideally at say around 2%, it has gone up to 5%, my value of the bond will go down, because whenever the interest rate goes up, my value, bond prices goes down. There is an inverse relationship. Okay. What is the impact on my portfolio? See, nothing is happening, but I am trying to see a stress scenario where if I change the variable, particular variable on which my business is dependent on, what is the impact that I will face? Simple. Let us go back to the book. Kindly read this part. They have given you an example of interest rate changing. Perfect. I am assuming everybody has read this part. I am going towards the next part, next section. There are two types of parameters that when you are looking at scenario, I have already mentioned it. When you are looking at the scenario, those scenarios can be historical scenarios. Okay, that means something which has already happened in the past. Okay, like for example, Black Monday. Okay, where the prices have, stock market has gone by 30%, 25% down. Okay, so that scenario, if that happens today, what is the loss that you will face? Okay, that is an historically sourced scenario. If I talk about estimated scenario, that means something which has not happened in the past, but I am taking my liberty of my imagination on seeing what is that situation that can happen. Because markets will react to that. Okay, read this part. The next paragraph, four lines. I hope everybody has read that first five lines. Let me take you towards this, the last three lines. Now, whenever we are doing scenario analysis or stress testing, ideally what we will do is we will create a model. Okay, we will create a model. Either we'll use MATLAB, Python, right? Or our own in-house system. Now, whenever we are using that model, there is always a chance that somebody who is inputting data in that model, okay, he did some mistake. So there is always a model risk or estimation risk. Estimation risk means the assumptions that we have made in the model or the answer that I'm getting from the model is not right. Because if I'm putting garbage in the model, obviously the garbage will come out. Okay, so there are so many risks associated with model risk that the model itself was incorrect. When I inputted the data, I inputted incorrect data point. For example, instead of date being added as DDMMYY, I inputted MMDDYY. Okay, and because of which everything changed. So that can be a model risk. So as a bank, we should be able to understand that our results that we are getting out of this sensitivity analysis, stress testing and scenario analysis is sensitive to those inputs and the way we are running that model. Simple. I hope everybody is with me till here. Give me a quick confirmation, guys. And there is a reason I'm asking you again and again. Because you guys will be involved in this entire process. So we are done with scenario analysis. We are done with stress testing also. We have particular chapter on stress testing in book 4. Where we will be able to see in detail. Okay, now what is enterprise risk management? Again, this same topic, we're going to be having an entire chapter in book one, which is foundation of risk management. Now, what is enterprise risk management in a very simple language? Previously, that means traditionally, when banks used to look at their risk, okay, what they used to do is bank used to have different risk teams. Today also they have different risk team, but how it was going is there was a market risk, there was credit risk, there was ops risk, then there is liquidity risk, okay? There is legal risk, there is a separate stress testing team. Now all of them are working in their silos. What does silo means? They are not interacting with each other, okay? And each team is having their market risk head, for example, credit risk head, ops risk head, and everybody is creating presentations, Excel, reporting into their own methodology. For example, market risk is using Power BI, okay, or Excel, but operation risk is using presentation. They are not doing anything in the Excel, right? So what is happening is the data which is going to the senior management was going in the fragmented way. They were not getting that complete picture. So basically now industry has moved towards enterprise risk management. That means they have a centralized system in which everything moves in, and they have a central way to manage the risk of the business. So what bank would do is, they would generally have a chief risk officer. Chief risk officer. In many banks, if the bank is very big, they would also have a deputy chief risk officer. Okay. Then within that, they would have the global head of market risk. Similarly, they will have a global head of credit risk. Okay, similarly for the ops risk. Now, these three are bigger risk component. Hence, you have a global heads for all of them. Okay. Then, ideally you have, for example, if market risk teams are sitting in India, Singapore and London. Okay, so individually, you will have the market risk head of individual site also. Now, since you have such a big organization in terms of risk only, then you create a centralized system which everybody is using. A centralized way of managing the thing that is called as enterprise risk management. Everybody is using the same methodology, same template of looking at it. So what happens is that if there is anything, any interaction between the risk, that means if anything happens in the operation risk side and it has an impact on the credit risk side, so because we are inputting data in the same system or we are following a standard approach, you will immediately come to know. The bank head, okay, the CEO or basically the head and the chief risk officer, he will come to know the entire view of the risk that is happening in the bank. Not only a particular market risk or an operational risk. That is basically possible when you have an enterprise risk management way of doing things. Right? Read this paragraph, the entire first paragraph. I hope everybody is reading that part. So previously everybody was working in silos. Silos means in their own individual teams. But right now, because of the enterprise risk management, you are getting a top-down approach. That means you are able to see everything from top to bottom. What is happening in multiple teams? What is the interaction? How an operation risk increasing will have an impact on the credit risk? So you are able to see that in detail because of this system or the way of looking at it. Okay. Now, obviously, this system itself also is having a lot of challenges. Okay. What is the challenge is that, read this first three lines. It tells you that enterprise risk management is trying to find a single number for the entire bank, that this is the risk amount. This is the risk amount. Now, in reality, this is not as simple as that getting that number, because there can be so many market related forces which can impact your business. I'll give you a very simple example. So there was this case of Metal Gesellschaft, which we have done a session in the previous way, where they had taken a huge quantity of positions. The similar thing happened in long term capital management. There was also a fraud, which is there in your book, not a fraud, basically a loss. Okay. So in that case also what happened is that they had taken such a big position, when they started facing loss, they started exiting that position in the market. That means they started selling those positions. But other players in the market, they also started copying. And because of which the prices fell fast and they started facing bigger losses. Now nobody anticipated this to happen, that the entire market will behave in a similar manner. Okay. So when you're looking at a single number of enterprise risk management, this is a very simplistic approach. In real life, things are going to happen very, very weird. Okay? So that is what this paragraph tells you, that in reality, things will happen very abruptly. So as a risk manager, you should rely on this number, but you should have your own subjective assessment also. Read this paragraph. Kindly read the paragraph from the screen. I hope everybody is done with this paragraph. I am moving ahead. Let us go to this part. Now, the intention of ERM is basically covered over here, that we want to make sure that everybody in the risk team, okay, basically works in a standard way, so that there is a bird eye view, the macro view of everything happening in the organization. Because what happens if, suppose I am running a program, if I am running a program that, okay, everybody in the team, everybody globally in the risk team is going to get trained, okay, you need a mechanism to track it. Okay, there can be so many things. If I am going to roll out a new policy which is going to impact all my businesses globally, right? So you need a mechanism to track that, what is the impact of that policy to all my businesses. Okay, so that is why this paragraph tells you that when we look at ERM, it is basically a company-wide integration of things to understand the risk in a better way. Read this paragraph. Read this paragraph. Madhusudan sir, I am not able to understand the point which you have made, which section it is related to. Everybody else, kindly read this paragraph. Now, we have completed the quantification and qualitative analysis of the risk. Let us go towards expected loss. Okay, now we have already talked about expected loss, that this is the loss that I feel is going to be normally there in my business, so I will take steps to do something, I will collect the commission fees and all, right? But how do I calculate that expected loss? Okay, if I look at some pure basic example of expected loss, expected loss is going to be PD into LGD into AAD. Now these are not difficult terms, these are very common sense terms. What is PD? Probability of loss, default. Okay, I'll give you an example, don't worry. Probability of default. What is LGD? Loss given default. LGD. Loss given default. This is also in terms of percentage. What is this EAD? Exposure at default. Or there is one more name for it, exposure amount. For loss given default, there is one more name as loss rate. Okay. Now this loss given default is basically coming from recovery rate. So 1 minus recovery rate is my loss given default. So suppose if my recovery rate is 30%, my loss given default is going to be 70%. Simple. Okay. This exposure amount is generally into dollar. This exposure amount is generally into dollar. I'll give you an example. Now suppose you are giving a loan to Vijay Mallya. Okay. So first thing that you will check is, what is the loan amount? Okay. The loan amount is, let us assume that the loan amount is $1,000. So my exposure, if I give this loan to him, my exposure is going to be $1,000. Okay. So next question that you will ask is, what is the probability that Vijay Mallya might default? Okay. Suppose that probability is 5%. obviously bank will have a separate model to calculate the probability of default. I'm just taking hypothetical numbers. Now next, you will try to calculate if Vijay Mallya defaults after taking my loan amount, what is the loss that I will face? Okay, suppose out of that total $1,000, I might lose 60% because 40% is what I can recover, I feel. Okay, so this number is going to be 60%. So you will multiply. What is the answer that you are getting? Come on guys, I would need the number from you guys. Multiply, let me know. What is the answer? 5% into 60% into 1000. 30. Now what does this $30 represents? That when I'm giving a loan to $1000, when I'm giving a loan to $1000 to a person, on an average, I can feel that I will lose $30 as of today. As of today. If suppose tomorrow, you come to know that Vijay Mallya is going to get bankrupt. His packing is back. So obviously, your probability of default will increase. Because now there is more chance that he will default, right? Next, your loss given default will also increase. Simple, this is the first scenario that I'm showing it to you. Second scenario is, suppose after taking that $1,000, he repaid $200. So now my exposure amount is only $800. So obviously my expected loss will also reduce. So the point I want to make over here is that expected loss, bank calculates every single minute. They want to calculate every time. It is not only at the time of taking the loan. They would try to calculate it as fast as possible. To understand the person whom I have given loan, what is an average loss that I face? Simple, this is an expected loss. Let me take you towards the first paragraph. Read the entire first paragraph. Do you see in that paragraph probability of risk occurring? That is probability of default. Dollar exposure of the risk event, that is exposure amount. The expected severity of the loss, that is loss given default or loss rate. Read that paragraph. I hope everybody has read this part. Now, if suppose you know that on an average $30 is what I'm going to face on the $1,000 loan that I'm giving, so I will try to include that in the calculation itself. How? Either I will increase the rate of interest slightly, or else I will ask for a processing fee to be done. That is from the bank's example. If you are selling some product, manufacturing product, then you would increase the price slightly to include that $30 loss that you might face. Right? Look at this example. The one which is highlighted. Kindly read this entire paragraph. The first example that they have given you is from the retail business perspective, where you have given a product to somebody. He becomes your debtor. This is a commerce term. Okay, debtor. And he's not paying you back. So then he becomes your bad debt, okay? And since you are doing business for certain number of years, you would have come to know what is an average percentage which of your debtors whom you have sold the product, they will not repay on the basis of your experience. Read that paragraph which is highlighted on the screen. All good? Right? The second example they have given you is from the banking perspective. Read this part. Expected loss is equal to probability of default into loss given default into the same formula that I had given you. The same formula. Simple. Now, how does bank will try to collect this expected loss? Either they will try for a higher spread. What is higher spread? That means if I am giving loans to normal people at 7%, I will try to increase it to 7.25, 7.2%. Okay. And the more granular I become, the more granular means if I am able to identify for each loan amount, what is the expected loss? I will be able to do a better pricing. That means I will be able to charge that customer properly. Okay. Now it is not easy for the bank to look at things at individual bank loan level, because there are so many things happening in a bank on a day-to-day basis. So obviously it is a complicated process. Read this part. So now expected loss tells you what is the loss that I can expect in my business on a day-to-day basis, right? So I will try to collect the money in such a way that I do not face that loss. That is the reason I said I will collect from the customer the processing fee, commission and all of that. But my main concern is unexpected loss. Read this section. This is similar to the diagram that I had shown you. The unexpected loss diagram. What is going to happen when there is a variation, when there is a variation in the expected loss? Read that paragraph. I hope everybody has read the first three lines. Now think from this example point of view, where they are referring that there is a commercial loan portfolio. Okay, commercial loan portfolio means you are giving loans to businesses, manufacturing company, auto company, airline companies, right? Telecom companies. You are giving a loan. That's a commercial portfolio. Now within that, you have a portfolio of automotive manufacturing companies. Smaller companies, you have given a lot of loan to them also. Now, when there is an economic expansion, look at that point. When the economy is growing and one or two companies defaulting, you're not worried about it. Ideally. Obviously, you will do your due diligence, you will check, but it will not impact the bank. But when there is an economic crisis and you see a customers defaulting, okay, then that becomes a big problem for you. Because you are not able to generate revenue from other sources. Okay, and again the bigger problem is if all of these losses come immediately in a short period of time. I'll give you an example. If suppose you realize that one of your customer has defaulted in January. Okay, other one is defaulted in after 3 months. Next one is defaulted after 5 months. Okay, but everything is happening in a cluster. That means in the same month, then you will face a bigger problem. That is called clustering of events. Right? Read this part. This entire paragraph, which gives you an example of unexpected loss. An unexpected loss would ideally happen when generally an entire economy is facing an issue. For example, during COVID, okay, people are their jobs are getting impacted. Okay, so you would realize that lot of credit card customers would default. So your normal loss would be at 3%. Now it would have gone to 25-30%. Because the economy is getting impacted. Right? Read this paragraph. Read that paragraph. Simple. Now this is an example of correlation risk. What does correlation means? Correlation means bad things. If suppose I am going down and I have a positive correlation with somebody else, he will also go down. Okay, so when we're talking about clustering, it is happening because of high positive correlation. One company defaults, everybody else starts defaulting. Okay, so if the correlation is very high in the market, unfavorable events are going to happen more together. Read that last three lines. Smith, answering to your query, that bank moratorium on EMI, okay, that means RBI putting moratorium on a bank, is actually a result because you are facing a bigger losses. But basically that is an outcome. That is not actually an unexpected loss. You faced loss somewhere else and you're not able to manage the bank. Hence, that was an action taken. Okay. I hope everybody has read that line. One more example of correlation risk. This is related to your 2007-8 crisis. This is related to your 2007-8 crisis. What has happened? If suppose bank is giving loan, home loan. Okay. So this loan is basically given to a customer and there is a collateral which is home kept. So if tomorrow you are not able to pay the loan, we will sell this house. Get our money back, right? Now, if you think of a scenario, people are defaulting and the home value is also going down, then bank is going to be in a big trouble. They are not even getting the money from the customer and they are not even able to sell the property in the market to get their money back. So this is a problem of correlation risk. People defaulting and the home price is also going down. This is precisely what happened in your 2007-8 crisis. So your recovery rate by selling the property would be very, very low. Read this paragraph. Read this paragraph and give me a quick confirmation. Are we good on expected and unexpected loss? Give me a quick confirmation as done on the chat section. Give me a quick confirmation if you are good on this topic of expected and unexpected loss. Please mention done. Okay. Perfect. Relationship between risk and reward. I'm starting with this logic. Okay. Now, ideally, this is connected to the first part. If there is greater risk, you're going to get greater return. If there is a greater risk, you're going to get the greater return. But the problem is variability of the risk. That is my concern. Okay. That is where we calculate expected loss, we calculate unexpected loss. Okay, read this part, the first paragraph. All good. I'm assuming everybody has read this part, the first paragraph. Now, taking you toward this example. Okay. The next part. Please be very careful on this lines. What is it talking about? Okay. For example, a government bond has less risky than the corporate bond. What does it mean? See, corporate bond is a risky asset. Why? Because if tomorrow you have put in your money in a corporate bond, there is slightly higher chances that the company might default as compared to the government bond, where suppose if you have bought an Indian government bond, Indian government can anytime repay you the money because they have the authority to print INR. So they can return your money back anyhow. Right? Obviously, there are other reasons also. They are bigger. Their revenue is higher. They can repay your amount easily. That's the reason you find the government bond being less risky, and hence the yield on the government bond, yield on the government bond is also be lower. Because the risk is low, the return is also very low. Okay, if you compare the corporate bond, since the risk is slightly higher, your yield is going to be slightly higher. Okay, yield is going to be slightly higher. I'll give you some example. If suppose I look at corporate bond, a 10-year corporate bond, it has an yield of 7%. And if I'm comparing it to the government bond of the same maturity, 10-year, okay, it has an yield of 4%. So my spread is basically 3%. This is my credit spread. I call it as credit spread. This represents the riskiness. This represents the riskiness of the corporate bond. Okay, so primarily, if I write it in a very simple language, what is happening? This corporate bond is basically giving you a yield of 4% plus a spread of 3%. That is how it is making, giving you 7%. Okay, this spread of 3%, which is extra, is basically because the risk that it holds, and that is in order to compensate for that risk, it is giving you the 3% return, extra return, as compared to the risk-free, which is government bond. Which is government bond. Fairly simple. Now, how does this spread change, or how does this yield change? I'll give you an example. Suppose if the price of that corporate bond is 100 and the income is 7%. That means the coupon, the interest on that bond is 7%. Then my yield is calculated as 7 divided by 100. That is 7%. That is what I had written initially. Okay. Now, think about this. If the riskiness of the corporate bond increases, then what should happen? Come on, guys. If the riskiness of the corporate bond is increasing, its price should increase or decrease? Its price should decrease. Right? Let us assume that it has gone to $90. Then in that case, the income is going to be same because it's a interest or the coupon. The market price has gone down to 90. What is the yield now? 7 upon 90. What is the number? Can anybody calculate? 7 upon 90, what is the number? Is it 77? No, not 77, sorry. 7.77. 7.77, right? Yes. So do you see that when the price is going down, your yield is increasing? When your yield is increasing, that means this is going on the right hand side, and the spread, which was 3%, is also going to increase. Now it is 3.7% spread. So indirectly, when the spread is increasing, that means the riskiness is increasing. Are you able to connect the dots? The price is going down, okay, your yield is increasing, and that is why your spread is also increasing. Simple. If you look at the other scenario, if suppose the price has gone to 110, then what is going to be the yield? What is going to be the yield? Is it 6.33 something? Cross check. Is it 6.33? Right? Now, 6.36. Okay. Now, Do you realize when the price is going up, the yield is going down? That means my yield is going in this direction. That means my spread is going to go down, narrow. That means the risk is getting reduced. So are you now guys able to understand what is a credit spread? This, when the spread increases, what happens? When the spread increases, is the risk increasing or decreasing? I'm repeating the question. When the spread increases, is your risk increasing or decreasing? Increasing? Simple. If the spread is reducing, that means your risk is reducing. You can think it this way, that you are moving closer towards the government bond. That means you are becoming like a government bond. So your risk is getting reduced. One more thing that you have to understand, when the price goes down, your yield goes up. When the price goes up, your yield goes down. You have to remember this. Simple. Now, we have just completed these three lines. Okay. Now, the spread that we are looking at, the spread that we had in the example of 3%, okay, that is only not only coming from credit risk. We do term it as credit spread, but there are other things involved. That means there can be liquidity risk also. Now come to this example again and see if suppose this corporate bond that I am referring about, there is a liquidity risk in this corporate bond. You cannot sell this corporate bond easily. Then that means whenever you need money, you might not be able to convert that into cash by selling that bond. And that is a risk for you, right? So obviously the yield is going to be higher, because you will not pay a higher amount for this kind of bond, right? You would pay a lesser amount, and when you are paying lesser amount, your yield is increasing. Simple. So it is not only the credit risk, it can be liquidity risk also. I hope everybody is with me. Liquidity risk means you are not able to sell that bond easily in the market. Okay. I've just taken an example from here. Now, there can also be an impact of taxation. Now, what is taxation impact? If suppose, on a government bond, you get tax benefit. And obviously, on a corporate bond, you do not get tax benefit. Now, think logically. If people are getting benefit on the government bond, then more and more people will buy government bond. When more and more people will buy government bond, what is going to happen? The price of the government bond is going to increase. When the price of the government bond is going to increase, its yield is going to come down. Right? So its yield will go this side. When the yield is reducing, do you see that the spread is increasing? This is an impact of taxation. Is everybody clear on the liquidity and the taxation effect? We're going to be closing the session in some time. Don't worry. Now, Raja, taxation means if government bond is basically giving you tax benefit, that means more people will buy government bond. That means the price of the government bond is going to increase. The yield will go down. That means the spread is very high. Simple. I'm going towards risk tolerance. Now, what is risk tolerance? Risk tolerance means the ability of the market participants to take risk. Ability of the market participants to take risk. Now, think logically. If everybody in the market is able to take risk, they are not afraid of taking the risk, then they will not be worried about this 3% gap. they will not be worried about this 3% gap. That means if more and more people are not afraid of taking the risk, the spread is going to reduce. Because now they will not be worried about holding a corporate bond. Because their ability to take risk is higher now. That means when the risk tolerance increases in the market, the credit spread reduces. Okay. When the risk tolerance reduces in the market, what is the meaning of risk tolerance going down? That means people are afraid. Even a slightest amount of risk you give, they would need higher returns. They are afraid. So when the risk tolerance is going down, what is happening? Your spread will increase. Because if you give them slightest amount of risk, they will need an additional compensation for that risk. Read the paragraph which is highlighted on the screen. Simple. I hope everybody is with me till here. We're going to be closing the session in some time. Let us come to this part. Now, because risk and reward, everything is linked. Okay. You expect that the expected loss is also going to change. When the borrower's PD into LGD and your EAD is multiplied, you get the expected loss. Right. If the financial condition of the borrower is changing, then obviously your probability of default and loss given default will change. Right. Now, the financial position of the borrower or Vijay Mallya is going to impact, first of all, on its own company, what is happening within the company, and also what is happening within the economy. That can also impact the borrower's ability to repay the amount. Read the paragraph which is highlighted on the screen. So basically, when we say that the probability of loss is increasing, okay, that can be because of the internal factors. Your business is not doing good, customers are not coming back, or else it can be because of some external factor. COVID, you cannot do anything, you have to close the business. Vani, answering to your query, if the risk tolerance is high, okay, people will buy corporate bond more. That's correct. So when the price will increase, your yield will come down and your spread will reduce. That's correct. Okay. I hope everybody has read this paragraph. Let us look at this last three lines. Now there can be so many factors which can affect the borrower. Okay, which can affect his ability to repay. Now, with the advent of obviously artificial intelligence and all of that, bank is trying to understand what is an important factor which impacts the borrower's ability to repay the amount on time. Read that last three lines. Vani, kindly confirm if your query is resolved. Now let us go towards the next part. In real life, the market is very complex. You cannot just say this is the factor that has happened. There can be so many things that can happen. Hence, we are using artificial intelligence, right? To identify in the future, we're going to be using those systems to identify what is impacting my business, what is impacting my risk. Look at this point. So what they are trying to talk about is, we are trying to identify correlation. That means things happening together, bad things happening together. That means my business is changing, my customer profile is changing, government is bringing in new rules. Okay, all of this affecting me and leading to a tail event. What is tail event? The extreme losses. That is going to be the concern of the bank, that when wherever they are doing the trade and transaction, these things which are going to have, and if those things which are going to simultaneously impact the bank and will result in a worst case loss for them. Read that paragraph. Simple. Let us also go towards this part, the next paragraph. It talks about conflict of interest. Now, what is a conflict of interest? Conflict of interest means the way I want to do things, it is going to be very different than what is expected from me. Okay. Now, for example, if banks are ideally supposed to not take heavy risk. Okay. But if suppose they want to maximize the profit, and they are taking heavy risk in their business, so what regulator is expecting from them and what they are doing is very, very different. Okay, that is what we call as conflict of interest. Okay, now this conflict of interest can also happen with the employee and employer. For example, I have a trader in my trading team. I have told him to take a risk up to certain level, but he is taking exceptionally high risk because he wants to make profit, and because of which your bank is getting impacted. Okay, so that is called as rogue trader. Rogue trader means somebody who is not following the rules. And because of that conflict of interest, he is taking risky bets to improve his own personal compensation, own personal profit. And because of which the bank is facing a loss. So there was a case of Baring Banks when only one person led to an entire collapse of the bank. Read that paragraph. Sanchita, answering to your query, tail risk event means extreme losses event where there is very high severity but very low frequency of happening. Rajat, you are talking about any specific point? Okay. Okay, lockstep movement means things happening together in sync. I hope everybody has read this paragraph of conflict of interest and you are able to understand what is that conflict of interest. A rogue trader taking risky position to get higher bonuses. Okay. Now, how do you identify and tackle this conflict of interest? The first is whoever is the manager. Okay. Or basically the frontline person. Now, this is not specific to rogue trader. But anybody who is doing a frontline job or basically managing, okay, they should be the first person to know that this kind of risk can come, and they should have a strong vigilant on those kind of activities. For example, the frontline officers sitting in the bank, the retail bank, they are looking the customer, they know the behavior of the customer. By looking at that, they can see if there is a risk involved or not. The second point is to have a robust system in place. That means there should not be any opportunity for people to bypass the system and do something, right? So in the case that I was talking about, Nick Clayson, he created a lot of fake trades which their system was not able to track. And in the system, he was showing profit, but in reality, he was making losses. So you should have a robust and a strong risk management system which should be able to track those things. The abnormal behavior. So now what happens if you are a trader and if you are making extraordinary profit on a single day or in a week, that is a red flag for risk management team to check what is he doing. Lot of banks, they keep a mandatory 2 week off for all the employees because they want to make sure that employee goes out and somebody else is doing his work and we are able to identify the risk. Okay. That is the second step. The third step is basically audit team. Independent audit team is coming and assessing the risk of the work. So ideally, we try to keep these three pointers to manage the conflict of interest. To manage the conflict of interest. Now, we'll be starting with the quiz. Quick quiz, which is available in the book also, right? So first question, which of the following statement regarding the risk in risk management is correct? Come on, guys. The first statement. Kindly mention your answer is 1 point A, 1 point B, like that. What is the answer for the first question? Okay, let me go to the option C. Is the option C correct? Is the option C correct? When we are looking at the steps in the risk management process, the last step was monitoring, not mitigation. Mitigation was second last step. So C is not the answer. Look at this. D, what does it talk about? If you are going to do the risk management properly, you will eliminate the risk in the economy. We read that risk will not get eliminated, it will get transferred. So D is also not the answer. Let us come to B. There is a relationship between the amount of risk taken and the size of the potential loss. That's correct. But when we talk about risk and risk management, we are more concerned about the unexpected loss, the variability in that unexpected loss. Hence, the answer is A. Answer is A. You can go and check the solution at the back. Let us go to the second question. Which of the following item is not a building block of risk management? Come on, guys. This is easy. Which of the following is not a building block of the risk management? We have seen the steps. Identification. Right? Please mention your answer as 2.A, 2.B. So identification of the risk was there. Measuring of the risk was also there. Attempting to quantify any unexpected loss was also there. Because we were looking at expected and unexpected loss. Avoiding all known risk was not there. So answer is C. Answer is C. Let us come to the third question. Examining the impact of dramatic increase in interest rate on the value of the bond portfolio could be performed using which of the following thing? Come on, guys. This is slightly tricky. Slightly tricky. The question number third I am referring to. Third question. What is the answer for third question, guys? Okay, we know that dramatic increase in interest rate and its impact on the bond portfolio. Stress testing is definitely an answer because we have already seen that as an example. But is enterprise risk management also an answer? Yes. Because when we talk about enterprise risk management, we want to understand the interlinkage between the risk. So when the interest rate is increasing, which is related to market side, what is going to be the portfolio impact of the bank is also considered in that. So answer is C. I know A is very tempting to do, but the answer is C. You can look at the solution at the back. Let us look at the fourth point. Read the option properly. The fourth point. Which of the following items would be associated with unexpected loss? Unexpected loss. Is it A? One, the loan defaults are increasing simultaneously while recovery rates are decreasing. Lending losses are covered by charging a spread between the cost of the fund and lending rate. What do you think, guys? Which of the statement related to the unexpected loss? Which of the following statement is related to unexpected loss? If you look at the second statement, it is related to expected loss, not unexpected loss. Because whatever loss I feel I'm going to get, I'm actually charging it in the spread. So second is not the answer. Let us go to the first part. Now if the loan defaults are increasing, right, more and more people are defaulting and my recovery rate is also going down. This is an example of an unexpected loss. Hence, the answer is A. Right. Answer is A. Let us go to the fifth question. Which of the following statement is incorrect with respect to the relationship between risk factor? We have read about this in detail. Which of the following is incorrect? Huh? Look at the question. Which of the following is incorrect? Read the option properly. Do you think that D is right? D is right because we read about risk management. You can do audits. We talked about it. What about this? Risk manager should do a granular. I talked about this. When we're talking about granular, ideally it's not easy, but they should look at granular level risk to identify the expected losses. Now look at this part. Risk management conflict of interest can be easily mitigated through stock-based compensation. We have not read about this part, but giving a stock option to employees doesn't mean that they will not do fraud. That is not the case. We have seen bigger employees or senior management of the company doing fraud even after getting stock options. So answer is B. For the fifth question, the answer is B. Right? So we have completed the solving of the quiz also. I am stopping today's session. We're going to be doing the continuation of this on the next Saturday. Okay? Next Saturday, we will keep a session related to this. Okay? Thank you very much for joining in. And please, people who have not subscribed to my YouTube channel, please do it. Because whenever I'm going to come live, throughout this week, I'm going to come live. So you will get a notification and you'll be able to see that live session also. So please subscribe to our channel. Okay. And we'll meet next week, Saturday, on the second part of this chapter. We might also keep some additional sessions. Okay. Sanchita, fifth, the answer is B, not A. Give me a quick confirmation, guys. Are we good to go till here? Perfect. So thank you very much, guys, for joining in. We'll be sending you the details on WhatsApp and Telegram. In case you have not joined my Telegram channel for FRM, there is a channel on FRM updates. With the link is in the description. You guys can join it. Okay. There are other channels also. In case of a query, you want to reach me directly, you can put it on the WhatsApp number. Okay. Which is 981. It is also available in the description. And I will revert back to you as soon as possible. Okay. So thank you very much, guys, for joining in. I'm closing the session.